See that?
Yep.
Okay. So thank you, Jesse, Joeva, and Brian for organizing this excellent series. I've really enjoyed it. I want to recognize my co-author, Eliza Pessereau, who can't be here today. She's a former McAllister student, spent the summer of 2019 with me in Burkina Faso doing fieldwork for this paper, which is coming out in an edited volume on rural transformations. The genesis of this project, I've been doing fieldwork in Burkina Faso since 2016, looking at the impacts of a GR4A rice project on participating women farmers. It's part of a larger cross-country study. Rachel Sherman and William Monroe are also part of that. They were in the previous session. And in the context of doing interviews for that study, I just kept noticing how ubiquitous herbicides were, and in particular, how frequently women were using them. And so I've been working in the region since the 1980s, and I started out in Mali before Burkina Faso, and it was just unheard of for women to use herbicides. You know, if men used them, it was for cotton production. So I thought this was interesting, and it deserved to sort of dig into it a bit more. And I kept thinking that this is like a more significant shift than the project in GR4A that we've actually been studying. And so here I want to reference Vicki Lawson, who's a geographer at the University of Washington, and she makes this distinction between big D development, which are sort of formal development projects like AGRA, and little D development, which is that economic change that's going on all the time in the background. And I think this is a case of pretty significant little D development. So the title of the paper is sort of a riff on this 1966 hit tune by the Rolling Stones, Mother's Little Helper. And we're drawing sort of a comparison here with the women of 1966 America, who were in an impossible situation, shackled by gender norms and patriarchal structures. And under these conditions, Valium was a very sort of understandable response. And in a similar way, we argue that West African female farmers have been placed in this impossible situation, attempting to farm their fields with limited power to requisition household labor. They're facing a shrinking rural labor pool and increasingly problematic weeds. So the sort of emergence of widely accessible and increasingly affordable herbicides has helped them to solve this problem for now. But the health consequences of this strategy, similar to Valium, have yet to sort of fully emerge. And of course, male farmers have adopted this same strategy. They've been at it far longer than women. But we think African women farmers represent in many ways the last frontier of the global herbicide revolution. And this just hasn't been sort of sufficiently studied. So we have three research questions. First, how are changes in the global herbicide industry influencing herbicide uptake in the local level? How do economic changes at the regional level influence the supply of agricultural labor? And third, how does the relative power of women to control labor within their households influence their adoption of herbicides? And I'm really going to focus on the first and third questions. And our hypothesis sort of has three parts. We argue that the rise of generic herbicide production in India and China since the early 2000s makes this labor-saving technology increasingly affordable to African markets. Second, that artisanal gold production has siphoned away labor from the farming sector and is constraining women's access to labor. And that third, women have limited control over household labor and thus face serious sort of labor constraints. And so under these conditions, herbicide use is a very sort of rational response, but it's also contributing to growing health risks as well as the spread of herbicide resistant weeds. We situate this study in sort of three bodies of literature. I'm just going to note the first one here. And we're sort of drawing on very disparate parts of political ecology. In North America, the work of scholars like Paul Robbins in his book, Lawn People, where he convincingly shows how large lawn care companies in the US were able to drive the uptake of agrochemicals. And then in Burkina Faso, referencing the work of Jesse Luna and Brian Dowd Uribe, you know, how they discuss how, you know, Monsanto was able to encourage the uptake of BT cotton in Burkina Faso. But in both cases, there's sort of a corporate push at the global scale, which is influencing dynamics at the local scale. In terms of research methods, we interviewed 141 women farmers in five different villages in June, July, 2019, asking them questions about their experience using herbicides, how they apply them, the reasons they started to use them, about the labor dynamics surrounding them. We also interviewed herbicide vendors at the village level, as well as in the major regional city, Bobo-Dioulasso, as well as an herbicide importer. And as I mentioned, this study is sort of related to this larger study on GR4A. And those are just our villages north and south of the regional town, Bobo-Dioulasso. So I'm gonna sort of approach this in a scalar fashion, first talking about broader scale dynamics, then mesoscale, and then local scale village dynamics. And these track with our three different research questions. And so in order to talk about this broader scale, we kind of have to talk about the value chain. So we interviewed 12 herbicide vendors at the village level. Many of them, they've been selling herbicides for 2 to 3 years. They are almost always farmers, and so this is a secondary gig, and they're selling the herbicides locally as well as in weekly rural markets. And they're buying these herbicides from large shops in the regional town, Bobo-Dioulasso, or from wholesalers. And these wholesalers and importers are sourcing these both globally as well as from neighboring countries like Guinea, Ghana, and Cote d'Ivoire. And these regional manufacturers are getting their major ingredient, glyphosate, from big generic producers in India and in China. And so many of you probably know that glyphosate used to be sold under the trademark name Roundup by Monsanto. It goes off patent in 2000. And other producers in the global north start to produce it, as well as producers in the global south. And it's really when those global south producers kick in, particularly in India and China, that we begin to see wider spread adoption and use of these in the global south. And in West Africa, it's particularly in these areas that have a tradition of cotton production, where there's been longer use of herbicides, that we see this more aggressive uptake of these herbicides. And I just want to mention, in terms of these being licensed for sale, there's a regional organization, SILS, and the way the process works is that if one country deems it to be legal and safe, then it becomes legal and safe in all 9 countries. So companies will target sort of the easiest country to open up that market. And scholars like Hagblag and co-authors have documented how glyphosate prices have declined pretty significantly in recent years. Here, I'm just going to say, I'm going to pretty much skip over this question, but artisanal gold mining is important. By some estimates, 2 out of every 3 rural households have at least one member who's working in this sector. The government of Burkina Faso suggests that we have 1 to 1.2 million people who are directly or indirectly involved in this. And so this is constraining labor at the household level for farming. So lastly, what's going on at the local level? So 92% of the women that we interviewed were using herbicides. If they weren't using them, the primary reason was lack of funds. Many of them talked about how they began to use herbicides about 7 to 8 years ago, around 2011, 2012. And they talked about, you know, why increased availability, lower cost. In some cases, they had access to land now, so they needed these chemicals. They had money to buy them. Some talked about sort of more pernicious weed problems. And older women would talk about how they just don't have the strength to sort of do the weeding in all these different fields. Women are applying these 1 to 7 times per year. You know, the biggest group, 48%, is applying them twice per year. Typically, they're applying a broad spectrum herbicide before plowing, and they would literally talk about how they would burn the field with the herbicides. Kajeni is the local Jula word for this. And then they're applying more selective herbicides later on in the season. And 89% of women talked about herbicide resistant weeds as a problem, and 33% think this is more of a problem than it used to be in the past. The household labor dynamics are interesting. Most women, when hand weeding was the major form of weeding, they would do it themselves, but now they're using paid labor in many cases, or male labor from the household to apply the herbicides. Other studies have suggested that herbicide application is much cheaper than sort of the cost of labor to do weeding. We found it fairly equal, but what's critical here is it's hard to get labor, so it's much quicker, and weeding needs to be done at a particular time so that it's most sort of beneficial for your crops. And lastly, the gender dynamics around herbicide application is fascinating. 92% of women don't apply herbicides themselves, all right? And this is very, very different than hand weeding, in which 97% of them would do this themselves. We thought there'd be differences between, thanks to Ava, we thought there'd be differences between sort of senior and junior wives and households, but we didn't find significant differences. When we asked women, why do you have male family members, or do you pay men to do this? They sort of looked at this like we were sort of crazy. And so it's a gendered task. It's thought that men should do this, but they would also talk about how they have sort of lack of strength to sort of carry around the backpack sprayers. And a minority of women, about 10%, did articulate some health concerns. They talk about leaky backpack sprayers, or concern that it would contaminate their breast milk, or in particular that it would be dangerous for young children. And this is not without reason. Glyphosate, you know, the top selling ingredient here, is a potential carcinogen and a known hormone disruptor. Atrazine, which is another common herbicide, is a teratogen and a hormone disruptor as well. So just to conclude, women are adopting herbicides with gusto as a way to address labor constraints. It's because they're easier to access than they used to be, much more affordable. This has to do with the rise of generics globally. And so this is it's an economically rational decision, but the health consequences of this are we don't know what's gonna happen with this. And so in terms of how do we address this? We think there should be more rigorous vetting of chemicals for use in the region, explore developing alternatives that are lower cost, but aware of sort of labor constraints, and privileging women farmers in extension efforts. And so I just want to acknowledge other members of this broader research team, the students and local research assistants, and then our collaborator, the National Institute for Environment and Agricultural Research. Thank you.
Thanks so much, Bill, and thanks for being right on time. I so appreciate that. I forgot to mention before, I do have these handy handwritten signs as if we were in person together, so I'll be using them. Serena,